The Dalai Lama sends his own bodyguard, the Tropji Regiment, to greet us. This is a rare occasion, the first time in history when an honor guard has turned out to greet Americans. It creates great excitement. We review their infantry and their practical native attire. As we approach the city, we enjoy our first glimpse of the magnificent 17th century winter palace of the Dalai Lama, and on a nearby hill, the temple of the healing Buddha. Through the west gate with its Chotan-peaked dome pass monks from remote lamaseries, natives, pilgrims, merchants, and traders. The population of the city is estimated at 20,000. Lhasa maintains contact with the outside world through the medium of a telegraph line used principally in trading relations with India. Little of the city is modernized, the installation of electric lights in 200 homes being probably the most conspicuous evidence. All year round, the people use their rooftops to wash and cook, work and play. The Feng Gang family. The wealth of Tibet is concentrated in 20 of these official families. Twice a Dalai Lama has been born into this circle. The father is a cabinet minister, and his son's wife, shown carrying her baby daughter, was an Indian princess before her marriage. Frequently, families engage the services of priests to pray solely for them. This school is attended by children of mixed, common, and noble blood. It is conducted by a monk who is also the telegraph operator. Two brothers of the Dalai Lama are students. The one shown here, richly dressed, bears a striking resemblance to the young pontiff. These uniquely dressed men are Nakpas, or Tibetan sorcerers, not recognized yet tolerated by the church. Their strange drums and bells are supposed to drive away the devil. They wander to all corners of the country invoking the spirit of an Indian wizard who came in the 8th century and delivered the Tibetans from the devils who allegedly tormented them. The favorite game of the children is chibi. The object is to keep the feather bird in the air as long as possible. No easy trick. Small Fry here ties his bird to a string. Tibet is still unaffected by the machine age. Hauling, planting, and harvesting are all done by primitive methods. The laborers, content with their lot, chant as they work. The Kamba dancers roam about Tibet in troops, living on the bounty of their audiences. They give performances in the small villages, in the streets, at the homes of the wealthy, and anywhere they can find spectators to contribute. This particular troupe is considered the most talented in all Tibet, and came to Lhasa for the 5 weeks of the New Year festival. In the great religious communities, they furnish the only entertainment of a theatrical nature. Their steps are the closest relation to folk dancing that is known in Tibet. Although the capers and gyrations can hardly be called original, they do give us an insight into the characteristics of the Tibetan people. Few races would have the stamina to engage in this performance, especially in the rarefied air of 12,000 feet. And yet these entertainers may put on several shows a day. The Tibetans populate a country where only the rigorous may survive. These folks laugh readily, have a happy disposition, make friends quickly, and rivalry is always good-natured. The grand finale of their performance is the free-for-all competition of the leading dancers. They choose their own style and give it their all. The Potala, in all its inspiring glory, towers above the city of Lhasa, just as the Buddhist religion dominates the life of the people. Under its gold-encrusted roofs are the tombs of the previous Dalai Lamas in jewel-studded sepulchres. The great road links the Potala, winter home of the Dalai Lama, with the summer palace, his residence from May until October. The lion of Tibet guards the gate of the summer palace. The grounds cover over 500 acres of gardens and animal preserves. The architecture of its buildings is considerably influenced by the Orientals, but its singular splendor is truly Tibetan. The ornaments bordering the roofs are covered with a layer of pure gold. The workmanship reflects the patience and inspiration of the people that contributed these buildings to their Dalai Lamas. The present Dalai Lama is 10 years old and will not assume absolute control of his people until he reaches 18. In the intervening years, the regent directs his studies and activities and is the temporary ruler of Tibet. There is no higher authority, religious or civil. During the absence of the Dalai Lama in the winter months, a major domo is in charge of the summer palace. This dazzling jade drinking cup with its gold cover and stand is the personal cup of the Dalai Lama. Our guide stands before a cloisonné elephant, which was presented many years ago to a former Dalai Lama by a member of the Chinese nobility. These are gifts that were presented to President Roosevelt by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. These exquisite religious tapestries known as tankas are unrivaled for their detailed handiwork. The summer palace is the home of many types of animals, amongst them a pony, mules, a spotted pony, a deer, a wild ass, some of his favorite ponies in the stable, wild blue sheep, camels which have been relieved of further labor, and a Tibetan mastiff, blood relation to the Saint Bernard, the grounds of the temple of the serpent demigod. Wildlife enjoys complete safety in all of Tibet, as it is contrary to their religious precepts to kill any animals or birds other than sheep and yak. Traveling according to custom, with their servants preceding them, the cabinet ministers are coming to a party at the British Mission, where we enjoyed the hospitality of Mr. Ludlow. Servants help their masters dismount. Our monk guide, who is usually late, arrives alone. A whole mutton is roasted for the occasion. The luncheon was given at the British Mission for the kashag, or cabinet members, and other lay and ecclesiastical officials. During the luncheon, we asked the three cabinet members to pose for their pictures. also high government directors of the Foreign Office. Lay officials. And luminaries from the monastery. With typical Tibetan pomp, our guests take their leave. Shortly after the party at the British Mission, we were invited to the beautiful palace of the Sarong family. The residence is one of the showplaces of Lhasa and evidences the dignity, wealth, and influence with which these powerful families are blessed. We were presented with an upso, a cute little Tibetan terrier, which became our mascot. Although Tibet is isolated from what we consider the civilized world, we found a highly developed culture. People conduct themselves with dignity and restraint. Their features are finely proportioned, and the women are strikingly attractive. Lhasa is surrounded by monasteries housing 40,000 monks. We are here being shown through the Sera Monastery, which itself provides living quarters for 6,000. We are preceded by provost monks with their padded shoulders. The Depong Monastery, with its 10,000 members, is the largest monastery in the world. Novices from the age of 5 and resident monks attend the examinations of the 3 candidates for the Doctor of Divinity. It takes 15 to 20 years study and training before they are eligible to qualify for the degree. Those that fail, and only if very influential, may take the examination again about 10 years later. The candidates are examined for 8 days by learned members of the order. The examiner slaps one hand into the other and shouts, "Answer." If the student answers wrong, he is given a severe slap on the arm. The candidate under examination wears a yellow helmet. If he passes, he gets an extra row of stitching on the crest. The monks take over the city for the 5-week festival of Losar, or New Year, 20,000 coming from the great monasteries. But to ensure law and order among the fun-loving Tibetans, provost monks with long poles keep the unruly in line. These members of the Phung Gang family are wearing the finery for the New Year festival. The Tibetan sense of beauty is manifested by the exquisite blending of costly silk brocades and elaborate array of semi-precious jewels. The seed pearls, coral, turquoise, jade, gold, and onyx are expertly fabricated into exotic and original designs. The headdress, encrusted with seed pearls, must be worn by all women of the noble families during the 5 weeks of the New Year ceremony. If they should go out upon the streets without this headdress, they would be sent home by a monk.